what we're doing today is I'm going to be showing Ian here. This is Ian.
Hello.
He's got his GoPro ready. How to float rig fish. So along the way of us doing this, you're going to follow along because I'm going to show the camera and you guys how I set up my float rigs and how we go through all the whole process here. Number one, leaving the dock and having a right tide. We got a fallen tide pretty much all day today. It's January. It's freezing cold. Perfect time to float rig fish. That's how I always tell everybody, when you see me dressed up like this, it's because it's time to go. So, first of all, I always use, and you've seen in the videos, I always use bait casting because spinning gear is the antichrist of float rig fishing. You don't use spinning gear. You have no control over your line. Okay? Here, on a bait caster, your thumb is always there. So you have complete control of your line. When you open the bail of a spinning reel and you're this float here is taken off behind the boat in current, because that's how we drift the floats out behind the boat. When you open your bail, you have no control. You can't control the speed of the float. It just, you open a bail, and unless you're playing your hand on top of the spool, you just don't have the right control. I have a friend who used to go with me, and he'd be over here on this with a spinning reel. I'd be over there with a bait caster. My line is tighter than a banjo string, going straight from my rod tip to my float tip, and he's got this big-ass belly of line. It's because he can't control his line. So, we start out with bait casters. Me, of course, I'm using the Daiwa Lexa 300 high-speed 7-to-1 gear ratio, okay, for the sheer fact that there's times when I turn this handle, I want the line tight that quick. I'm, of course, an ugly stick user. I use a 7'6" buggy whip. It's an absolute fairy wand, as an old buddy of mine used to call my rods. I mean, we're talking fairy wand. Why? Trout have very tender mouths. Their mouths break away, they rip, they tear. So you don't want to pull the hook by having too stiff of a rod. We'll start off. 7'6" ugly stick has the flex, but at the same time, we use a 7'6" because you can hold it out the side of the boat when you're making a long drift with your float. You can reel, reel, reel. And when you sweep up to gather line even, that 7'6" is picking up a whole bunch of line at one time. Okay? And we'll go over that part. But the, as I always refer to it as the nomenclature of the rod and of the float rig, is basically we have a stopper knot. This rides up and down on our line. I'm using like 50-pound braid, just generically 30 to 50-pound braid is what I use. Okay, braid floats on top of the water like a floating fly line, okay? It doesn't sink. Mono, back in the old days, people used 15, 20-pound mono. The mono would kind of sink down and then come up to their float. Okay, so you always had that line in the water. Now our line lays right on top of the water. So I got a stopper knot. That's just a little string tied. You can use it. I use 20-pound mono just to do these. Some people like rubber bands. They tie a rubber band on there in such a way that they can slide it up. Then a little tiny bead, because the float goes up and bangs into the bead. Again, don't ask me where I get these, because I won't tell you. This is the secret double whammy float. So then from the float, this is what I do. I make a knot with a double line. down here. Let me pull this apart. Something like that. And the reason being is, this is set up for really fishing, say the Jetties or something, where you're fishing in a lot of snaggy situations. So when my float, right now it's hitting that with a little tiny bead, and I just make a big old knot there. Because, let's say my sinker gets stuck. Well, it's down there in the craggy area. Mm. I want to have...
Now you're double tested
there. Double tested, right? Gotcha. And let's say it does cut here. Let's say it gets cut there. Anywhere around here. And doesn't get cut up here. Then that knot will bring my float back home. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. It brings my float back home to me. Because as float rig fishermen, we always love our float to come home. From the sinker south to the leader in the hook, basically is all sacrificial. Mm-hmm. We don't care. With the leader and the hook really being sacrificial.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay? So, this also, and I made, I said this in an older video one time, this also makes a wonderful place to store this. You loop it around here like this. And on a high, on a low profile, high speed bait caster, you got that gearbox, and now you can tighten it up and you can travel, and this ain't flying all over the place. Keeps it low, low profile. Okay. So that's another reason why I do this. So then the nomenclature of the float rig is around here we use 2 ounce weights. That's called a trout lead. Most people would call it a torpedo sinker or something. Well, it's always going to have at least one swivel on the end. Always put the swivel towards the leader. Now, you can use a 1, you can use a 3, you can use a half, you can use whatever you want. But generally, in this current that we have here, a 2 works best because it's like a downrigger. This would be the boat, right? And the boat's trolling along, and it's got a downrigger, let's say, to a weight. What you don't want is blowing back.
Yeah.
As the float is drifting along,
it's keeping your line.
You want this kind of straight up and down.
Yep.
Okay? And at the same time, for me, everybody can handle this amount of weight as they learn how to bait cast while mm-hmm. they're doing this. I go to about a 30-inch, I guess, leader of sacrificial monofilament. And this is like 15 or 20 pounds of mono. Then one of the other things I'm real adamant about is I buy all my hooks with a turned-in eye. And I smell my hook by going around there because that is a super, duper strong connection. Super strong. And then I use these, what they call Matsuo sickle bend bait holders with the turned in eye, because that hook is so wickedly sharp you can't even touch it. Look, see how that's just grabbing onto my, you can't even touch this hook without getting stuck. And they're cheap. They're not expensive. You go buy Owners or Gamagatsus or all them other ones, god dang, they're expensive.
Oh yeah.
These here, you can get these hooks in 25 packs for $3 or something at Cabela's. They're the number one dealer for them. So, that is the start of the float rig system. You look at your sounder, and we're in 17, almost 18 foot of water. Right there. Now, that's important. You got to know what depth you're in when you're float rig fishing. If you know your depth, you would set this so literally your hook straightened out would be 1 foot off the bottom. You want your shrimp about 1 foot off the bottom. You don't want them. Sometimes he's going to drag the bottom because you just don't know what it is behind you. But you'll know if your shrimp's beat up or he's dying every time you drift or whatever.
So in this case where it's 18 feet, you're going to pull that stopper
knot up? I'm going to pull this stopper knot up to
16,
17 feet.
Oh, wow.
Something like that.
When
I knew exactly.
I don't move my stopper knot. I keep it at that length no matter where I'm at. So
I knew that when you told me
that
you were using this and you weren't catching anything.
Yeah.
This is the do-all for all of Northeast Florida.
Yeah.
I've been out to Jetties, hooked tarpon, shark, pompano, redfish, trout, flounder, drum. You name it, it catches it.
Yep.
Anybody who eats a shrimp. The whole idea, though, is you always want current because your float either needs to be floating away from the boat, and if it's not floating away from the boat, you bring
still?
It back. No.
Gotcha. Okay. I typically want mine sitting still because anytime I am in a spot, either the current's going the opposite way and it comes back to me, or it's just it seems like it goes past where I want it to go.
Well, I tell everybody, you pick a spot along the bank, mm-hmm. you draw a straight line out from it, and many times I'm going to tell you where to go. Mm-hmm. You're going to go out to that point, mm-hmm. you're going to stop, you're going to bring it halfway back to the boat, push your button, let her go again, lather, rinse, repeat, just like a shampoo bottle.
Gotcha.
Either your float is moving, either going out fishing or coming back to remake another fishing drift.
Gotcha.
So let's take the next step is how you pin on a shrimp. There is all kinds of ways of pinning on a shrimp. And then there's the way that always works. I'm doing double duty on them today. My pump, my live well actually brings fresh water in. But I'm trying this. I'm going to run the bubbler on them. Even though, just to make sure and see if they stay even lively. So, we go down here, and we dip ourselves a shrimp. Live shrimp. Don't use the biggest one in the barrel, okay? Because you save those for when you really need them. So you go in here, let's say you grab a shrimp like that. There's your average size shrimp. Then you're going to go and you're going to take your hook. Okay, you take your hook point, you hold your shrimp. Now, every shrimp has a horn, unless he's been in battle or something. Okay. But the horn is like your fingernail. It's just a little brittle thing. You can just break it right off. You don't have to break it off. I'm just breaking it off just to show you how brittle it is. Okay. You're going to take your hook, and where that horn meets the top of his head is the thickest part of his entire body in hardness. Mm-hmm. You're going to take your hook, you lay it this way across the shrimp's horn right at the base.
Yep.
And you pull through.
See, I've been doing that, but I think the hooks I use are too big.
Oh, of course.
So they bust off the...
There's another reason.
Bust out. Yeah, so
another reason to use a micro hook.
Yeah, I gotta get some.
Now, here's the biggest reason to use a small hook overall. Is he's wearing a hook hat.
Can't see it.
Okay. He can carry this while swimming. He can literally... swim around carrying a little hook hat.
The other one dragging them down.
The other one is like making them look all cattywampus or something, right?
That's the problem. All right.
Okay. Because you always want your shrimp to swim. If he's not swimming, he won't catch a quality fish. So, let's go over here now and show you what he looks like when he is swimming. He will be upright. And his finlets will move. His finlets are these, right here. That's how he propels himself, with the finlets underneath his tail. Now, say if I'm set at the proper depth. Okay, I'm just for shits and giggles, I'm gonna just do this. Let's just say it's, 8 feet behind the boat or something. So I'm gonna take this. Reel down, you reel down basically to your, just about like that much. And then what you're going to do is you're just going to let it over the side. And you're going to let it start drifting. See how it's drifting there? Now, there's trout current, and then there's not trout current. Trout current is when the float just moves along at a speed in which would just be a walk. You as a human walking down the street. See now, I'm just letting that float go. With this big long rod, 7'6" rod, what we end up doing is we do this, we call it mending our line. You always pick that line up and drop it behind your float. All right? And then, of course, on the bait caster, here's what you're doing. You're letting line go. And you're going to go out, like we said, to a prescribed area back there. You're going to go out oh so far. And then if you don't get bit, you're going to bring it in. But when we go to set the hook, you don't even really have to set the hook. See how I'm right now? I'm mending my line. I'm making sure that line's straight behind from my rod tip to my float. When that float disappears and it's gone, because the hook and the shrimp are in a fish's mouth, there's two things that you need to do. Number one, your thumb is right there, right? Sometimes I drag my thumb on there and I don't even have to look at my float. I feel this go zip, 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 zip real fast. Well, being that this is a high-speed bait caster, here's all I need to do. Oh, my float's gone. Fish, and then I lift up. I actually watch it go down, and I gather up all my slack until I feel the fish. Then I lift, and then I fight them on the rod tip, and I fight them nice and easy. Because if it's a giant trout, 99% of all those trout, 99% of every trout, just by you doing this and stopping his motion and lifting up on him, you've already tore the lip. You've already tore it in his mouth. But one thing we don't do, and it's funny because I take out the bass fishermen, you don't go along drifting it. My float's down. Swing for the fences. You will not believe how many people want to do that. Oh, yeah. This is a relaxing way of fishing, and all you need to do is drift it. And when the float goes down, you go, oh, my float's down. Believe me, three turns of this spool, you have just accumulated a lot of line. Mm-hmm. If it's a big fish, we run damn near no drag. If it's a big red or something, you just let them go. Because you always got your thumb there. You put your just thumb on there, you just added a little more pressure, right? And you're going to just bring them in just like that, nice and easy. And that's it. So what we're going to try here is we're going to try to set it at the right depth. This isn't any particular spot. And we're going to make a few drifts and just see if we catch something. So let me bring it in. But see, what I would do is I'd send it out to an area. And then if I know I still have a shrimp, I'd bring it halfway back to the boat. I don't need to look at my shrimp every time. And I'd push the button and let it re-go again. About every third or fourth drift, I'll bring it back to the boat because I want to check the condition of my shrimp. If he's not swimming, and how you do that is, you just drop him in the water and go with the current and see if he's upright and if he's fluttering. If he's not upright, he's not fluttering, I throw him on the here and use him for something later, and I put on a new one. I brought eight or nine dozen live shrimp this morning, and the reason being is because you're going to go through that many on a proper day of float rig fishing. And that's pretty much it. And then when I check them, I don't hold them up and go, hey, Mr. Shrimpy, are you okay? No, I take him over here. And I throw him on the side of the boat, and I see, is he still fluttering? Is he swimming? Because you got to remember, you're going after a predator, and a predator likes to kill live things, not dead things. Predators wouldn't be, that wouldn't be a predator, that would be a scavenger then. Mm-hmm. Right? On the float rig. You might make a keeper. Now let's see. Okay, you got him good, but see his mouth?
His mouth is all torn.
They still tear.
Really easily.
No matter what. Okay, keeper. All right. £20 ice. 15-inch trout. 20 pounds ice. Barely. Barely. Might be a 15-incher. We'll have to put him in a trout stretcher. I think he's 14. Oh! Well.
He looks like he's free now.
He's free!
And he's gone. I gotta start doing that a little bit better.
What the hell's this boy doing? It's called catch and release of probably legal fish. Okay.
Cool deal, man.
No wonder. How do you know it's just not a giant trout?
Or if it's a giant trout, I think that would actually be cooler. I've caught enough for rides the past couple days. A giant trout would be
giant.
Awesome. A giant.
A giant giant.
Oh, my battery died. Well,
how about if it's a giant sheep's head? Oh, your battery's just crapped.
Just cracked on me right as I get it to the boat, man.
Okay, nice and easy. This is go time right here at the side of the boat.
Listen to that.
Uh-oh.
Line peeler.
Why were we thinking about leaving?
Who knows? A little line peeler. Woo!
Why did I put my rod up?
Wow. I said, I'm just going to give it one last float before we leave.
That's the way it always is. That's the way it always is, isn't it?
Dude, I wish I had my battery in my camera now. Yeah. This is
You'll be able
fish.
To watch this video.
Yeah, that's right. Woo-hoo. I mean, holy hell.
Who let them dogs out?
Right? Let us see you.
Come to the net cam. I got tons of shots of your float. This is called Watch the Float video.
I mean, he doesn't want to come to the surface.
Well, guess just you, man, you got him on that little ass hook.
I mean, it could be a black drum. Unless it's a huge redfish.
I haven't caught a black drum here in a while, but you never know.
I mean, you don't know.
It's a giant
it's
red.
It's a giant red.
It's a big RB, Brutus T. Red Bass. Okay.
Come to daddy.
Wah! Net cam. All on the float rig. Float rig.
What's your guess?
I think just barely legal. If he
oh,
is.
Really? I mean, that's a perfect tournament fish then. I mean, that's a fat boy too.
Not really, he's 28 inches.
28? Okay, yeah, too big.
You know, you pinch their tail, you know.
Yeah.
He's just short of 28. But see, right there, in the old days, here's how you do it. Look at that. Boom, 27 to the exact. Now you go like this.
They make you pinch their tail, yeah, and it's...
There's a loophole in every law. It helps you out on a 17-incher and mm-hmm. screws the shit out of you on a big one.
Yep.
Now, if I do it... Yeah?
6.5.
Well, look at it. Look at that and tell me it doesn't say dead on 7 pounds.
Oh, yeah, it does.
Might be a small one. Nope. 14 and a half, maybe. Put him in a trout stretcher. All right, let me try it.
First drift, bud.
Yeah, that's always a good sign. Oh well, there's always a lot of small ones around. That's for sure. Yeah. a bluefish. No
oh,
wonder.
Right as I was about to drag it in.
Oh, now you got one.
Yeah, right as I was
mine's a damn bluefish in. Piece of crap.
I think mine
might be.
I mean, that was the babiest hit that I just got.
Well, might be a bluefish, because this was a really small hit, too.
Right at
the oh, I hate them things. The green scourge is what I call bluefish. The green scourge. Well, we found the nursery.
Yeah, they're here.
We know where the nursery is. The nursery is speckly bastards. All right, let's show the hook getting. Now, I've heard hook tailing them. Or hooking them in the tail. I've heard everything, but guess what works for me? Right under the horn. I have no problems. I've caught trout for years doing it just like that. Okay? And then I go someplace and some dude's telling me to hook them in the tail like I don't know what I'm doing. Yeah, well, guess what? That day we caught, that was up at Fernandina, we caught, I don't know, what, 20 sheep's head, a couple trout, a bunch of reds. Yeah, we didn't know what the hell we were doing. Never fished up there a day in our lives, and still caught the hell out of fish. That was in February. On the slab. Yes, sir. Nice yellow mouth. Well, not nice. I've caught them 7 pounds, but for right now, we'll take it. See the difference?
Yeah.
See how he's got kind of a checky pattern in it?
Yep, I gotcha.
All right, that's the difference.
I've caught those off the end of the dock, too.
Yeah.
That's the difference, gotcha.
Now, you'll catch a sand trout,
and they'll
he'll
all
be
the
pure
trout,
silver. He'll have no checks in him, like.
They all have the same limit, right? All trout are 15?
No, these guys are like 12 inches at 100 pounds per person per day.
Oh, really? So those are just different than sea trout?
Yeah.
So
these are
that's
called,
a keeper?
Yeah, this is a weak fish.
Gotcha.
They call them weak fish.
Gotcha.
These get up, I've seen these 12, 14 pounds in New Jersey.
12, 14 pounds?
Yes.
Mean, that's
they get
giant.
Really, they get really big up there. Really big. Let's see, I caught a speck before the yellowmouth, so just so you know, they do... The slabs with a little piece of bait on it, jigged off the bottom, do catch speckled trout, except for he was only 6 inches long. Oh, a little bit better yellow mouth there. That's what I'm talking about. I want ones like that, at least. We're burning down the house. Burning down the house. Catching. Small fish. This might actually be a keeper. Burning down the trout village. Probably won't even be a keeper. Nope. 14 and 3/4 inches. Oh man, that's a bogan. Now that we're out here at the Jetties, where all the big fish roam. Look at that. You left the redfish scale on the measure board. I'll tell you the funniest story ever. This says, I just got this. It's brand new red. Bright, shiny red. I just got it. I take a guy, it's like May. We go way downriver. First drift of his float, he catches a trout like this.
Yeah.
It was like 7 pounds. First drift! And I said, oh, let's measure that. And he pulls out the board and he goes, redfish measuring board. Are we allowed to measure a trout on this? Me and his daughter laughed until we were crying. All right, well, we're ending our day here. Up at a creek, everywhere we've been, the trout have been a lot of small ones. And there's one right there.
Little babies.
We're fishing these nursery grounds, and, but At least Ian had a chance to learn how to do the float rig.
Yeah, it was a nice something to learn. Come out here, learn all about depth of the float rig. It's not all about just having something sitting on the top of the water.
Yeah, or the bottom.
Dangling your bait, or the bottom sitting in one place. It's all about covering some ground, getting from the start to the finishing area.
Yep, well, we've tried it all. We've been at the Jetties. We've been everywhere today. And now we ended up in the creek and we're still finding nothing but little dinky trout.
Little babies all day.
All day, little babies, one after another. So that's what we did. We're just finishing up some shrimp and then we're gonna head in. One last spot, river, Jetties, creek. Yep, this is Secret Spot 2002. Secret Spot. Stick a fork in me. I'm done.
Decided to stay a little longer.
Yep, and he caught a flounder right where I just lost a trout. By one bite, and then he goes back and catches a nice flatty. All right. God dang it.